morning we'll find our scripture reading from the book of Psalms. We'll read together Psalm 1. Psalm 1 will also be the text which our message will be based this morning. Psalm 1, you can say, is really the introduction to the whole book of Psalms. So Psalm 1, we'll begin reading God's Word at verse 1. We'll read God's Word as follows. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a plant, or he is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff, and that the wind blows away. And therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. So far, the reading from God's holy word. Brothers and sisters of our Lord Jesus Christ, I noticed that it's Family Day Monday. There's quite a few families with young children that are missing today, but there's still a few children here this morning. And I was just wondering with you children whether you ever read any books, and do you enjoy reading books? If you're not in the habit of reading books, well, you know, then you miss something, because books help you to know and learn things about what's going on in the world. It helps you to explore different things in different parts of the world, and even things about your life and about the life of other people as well. So if you want to explore the world and want to know more about the world, you need to read books. So if you don't do that, then make that a good habit and start learning to read books as much as you can. But think for a moment about maybe the last book you read, if you were reading any books. Think about the people in that story that you were reading about. And I think it's probably a good chance that in the story that you read, there were probably good people and there were bad people. Maybe if you read a detective story, then you can say that the detective in that story was the good person. You might even call him the hero. Right? So in children's books, it's usually a young person who is the detective, who sets out to find the evil person who has done something wrong or committed some kind of crime. And when you get to the end of the story, well, the hero, the detective, the boy, the girl, they have solved the mystery, the bad person is caught, and he or she goes to jail. Well, such a story shows us the kind of things that happen in the world and reflect what you see in the world in which we live. Right, there are good people in the world and there are bad people who hurt others. In the real world, the good person doesn't always win like they do in the novels. Often in the world, bad people seem to be the ones who win and who get what they want. So a very important question that we're going to ask this morning is, who are good people and who are indeed bad people in this world? You know, the Bible constantly talks about good and bad, talks about good people as righteous people and about bad people as wicked people. Well, the book of Psalms starts with a song that introduces all the other songs in this book. And Psalm 1, you can say, is a wisdom psalm. And wisdom is something that always tells us about how we should live, the right way to live. It shows us also the difference between good people, righteous people on the one hand, and bad people, wicked people on the other hand, so that we know the difference between what is good and what is bad. Well, the righteous, or the good people in the Bible, are those who love the Lord and who serve the Lord. The wicked, bad people, you can say, are those who don't like God who hate God, who refuse, don't want to obey the Lord God. And so Psalm 1 teaches us that all those who serve the Lord, psalmist says, they're going to be blessed. They will be happy. But all those who refuse to serve the Lord and don't want to love God, they're going to be destroyed by God. And the very last word of the psalm says it says they will perish. That means they will die forever. And therefore, the Lord always reminds us that there are only two ways to live. One way is to love and serve the Lord, and the other way is to reject and to hate God. Those who love the Lord are called, as I said, the righteous. Those who hate God and don't want to serve God are called the wicked. The one way leads to eternal life with God. The other way, the Bible says, leads to eternal punishment in hell. And so the question for us also this morning is, so do you love? Which way do you love? Do you love the way of that? Do you love the way of life, or do you love the way of death? And you might say, that's a pretty simple answer. I don't love the way of death. I love the way of life. And yet, the reality is that most people in the world, they choose the way of death. And they don't even realize it. They don't even know that they're choosing the way of death. And so how you choose will show also whether you are a wise person who understands what the Lord God teaches, or whether you're a foolish person so that you don't understand what the Lord God is teaching. And so this morning, we'll listen to God's word under this theme, the righteous delight in the wisdom of God's law. So the righteous delight in the wisdom of God's law. We're going to look at three things. First of all, we'll see that the righteous separate themselves from the wicked. Secondly, that the righteous are contrasted with the wicked. And thirdly, the righteous are blessed while the wicked perish. The very first words that you find in this psalm and the very first words of the book of Psalms is blessed is the man, or blessed is the woman. The very first words of the psalm expresses joy. To be blessed means that you are living in a happy situation, a good situation, one that gives you much pleasure. And maybe the best way to try to understand what it means to be blessed is to keep in mind that the opposite of being blessed is to be cursed. Well, you know that all of mankind, people over the whole world, they live under the realm of God's almighty power. God is watching over the whole world, all of mankind. And under God's power, we enjoy God's blessings, in which God loves us and cares for us, or we live under God's curse, or we live under God's wrath, in which he is angry with people. If you live under the curse of God, it means that God will no longer protect such a person's life. It means that if you live under God's curse, it means that God will not give you the good things that you need. Instead, you will experience God's wrath, and God's judgment will be on you forever. There is no future for those who live under the curse of God. But when you live under God's blessing, that means that we are living there under God's love. Now, if God loves you, that means he cares for you. In his love, he takes care of all of your needs. He will give you the gifts that you need. He will protect you from danger. That's a promise that you find throughout the Psalms. But you know, although we live under God's love, we have to keep in mind that doesn't always mean that a life of a Christian, a believer, is always good and that there's never any troubles in our lives. Because when you read some of the other psalms in this book, there are times that psalmists will speak about how hard life is, and they will cry out to God, God, come and help me because my life is difficult. Right? Sometimes they're dealing with terrible sickness that makes their life really hard. Sometimes there's famine. Sometimes there are troubles in their life. And then so many times the psalmist talks about the enemies who are making their life hard. And so when the psalm begins with these words, blessed is the man, that does not mean that in this life as God's people we're always going to have it easy. It doesn't mean that there are going to be no challenges and no hardships in your life. And therefore, if we say that the righteous are blessed or the righteous are happy, happy doesn't mean that we're always on cloud nine and we're feeling really good about ourselves, as if there are never any troubles. But being happy here means that even when we are faced with troubles of this life, even when there are things that make our hearts heavy, the righteous man and the righteous woman knows that the Lord God is watching over them. And we know, as a well-known song says, that it is well with my soul. And so at the very beginning of this psalm, there is a sense of joy and happiness. For the psalmist says, blessed is the man. So we need the question, so who are those who are really blessed? Who are the blessed ones in this world? Well, notice, first of all, he describes the difference between the two. And first of all, he talks about those who are not blessed. In verse 1, he says, blessed are those who do not. Blessed, he says, are those who do not walk in the counsel of the wicked, who do not stand in the ways of sinners, who do not sit in the seat of mockers. So you notice a person is not blessed if such a person is not walking, is not sitting, or a person who's not blessed is a person who does not walk, does not stand, does not sit with those who are wicked. Actually, I have it backwards here. A person who is blessed is somebody who doesn't stand, sit with those who are wicked. Well, you think of three things are mentioned here by the psalmist in verse 1. It talks about to stand or to walk, to stand and to sit. And when you think about those three things, those are the things that we do all day long. If you think about your own life, right? When you're busy throughout the day, you're walking from here or there, you're doing things and you walk. Or you're standing as you're busy with whatever you're doing. Or you're sitting. You're doing one of those three things. And so really what it describes is the totality of our whole life. Well, he says here that a blessed person never walks, first of all, in the counsel of the wicked. Well, that word counsel refers to the advice that the wicked or that the ungodly give to people. You know, in our society, you can say that the counsel or the advice that God gives in his law is rejected. And those who are wicked and ungodly, they will tell people, you should walk not according to what God says in his word. Don't listen to God. Because God just makes your life hard and miserable. Just do what you please. Just do whatever you want. And so the counsel of the wicked is, you follow the desires of your own heart because that will give you the most pleasure and the most joy in this life. And so, if you think of our society today, the wicked will counsel, for example, you know, it's okay. It's okay to break your promise in your marriage. It's okay to divorce if you don't like the other person anymore. Now, I'm not talking here about maybe somebody who abuses or is abusive in the marriage relationship. But generally speaking, when somebody finds somebody else that they like better, they don't think nothing of leaving the marriage relationship and going. As if, you know what, it's more important that I'm happy than that I should make my wife or my family happy. And that's the same thing with people don't think twice about abandoning their children. If I find somebody else, I'll just leave my children behind and I will go and do my own thing. Right, that's the counsel that you find in the world today. Or you will find the counsel, you know, if you have a pregnancy and you don't want to have this child, just abort a child because you don't want to be stuck with something that you don't want to have to deal with the rest of your life. Or they will counsel you, you know, lead a hedonistic life, meaning just go and enjoy whatever you want to enjoy because you deserve it. Just enjoy life to the fullest today, because that will give you your happiness. And so you notice here that the wicked always counsel people to walk in a way that is different from the Lord God, and with the understanding, they say, that you'll make your own life much better and much happier if you do that. Secondly, the psalmist says, a blessed person will not stand in the way of sinners. See, the Bible often talks about the way that you live as the way. And so the way of God, you can say, is different from the way of sinners. God, in his law, reveals the way in which we should live and under which we will be blessed. But the way of sinners is always against the way of God, for sinners will live according to their own pleasure and their own desires, as we've just talked about. Right? They care more about themselves than they do about God and than they do about their own neighbor. I'd rather take care of my own needs and my own pleasures, and I will do that at the expense of my neighbor if that makes me happy. And a blessed person, in the third place, he says, will not sit in the seat of mockers. Well, you know, mockers have no regard at all for the law of God. In fact, they ridicule the law of God, and they mock also all those who walk and who live in the ways of God. Right, they will ridicule believers who serve the Lord. And what do? They stir up strife against the righteous with their insults. But right, the wicked and the mockers are good at insulting the believers, as if somehow there's something wrong with your brain. How can you possibly believe in God and serve him, is the way that they will speak. You see that also so clearly in many of the protests that are taking place in the streets of the United States today, in which you notice that when they also promote all these different causes, that they have no regard at all for the views of others, especially those who are Christians or believers. And they mock all those who disagree with their ungodly and wicked views. And so a blessed and a righteous man, the psalmist says, will not sit in the seat of such mockers. That means a righteous man is going to keep him or herself separated from the wicked who counsel people to go against the will and to go against the law of God. And now he says, and positively he says, and a righteous man is someone whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. You see, a righteous person lives in a completely different way from a wicked person. The attitude of the wicked, the attitude of sinners and mockers, is one in which they deny that the Lord God is God. And therefore they hate God's law, and instead they want to promote their own ideas about wickedness and perversion that they have. That means, really what happens is their mind is completely closed to anything that is good, anything that is upright, and they focus their mind on that which is sinful and that which is against the will of God. On the other hand, the righteous are those, psalmist says, who love God, who humbly look up to the Lord to help them, and who love the counsel, who love the wisdom that the Lord gives to them in his law. I want you to see here the difference in focus, beloved, between the wicked and the righteous. The wicked, they focus on their own selfish desires. They focus on getting what they want and what they think is going to make them happy. That's on one side. Whereas those who are righteous, they focus on the Lord God. They focus on what the Lord wants, what the Lord desires. And you know what happens? They're the ones who enjoy the blessings. They are the ones who enjoy the riches of God. And so here there's an irony. And we need to understand this irony in order to also appreciate what we have as God's people. You see, it's ironic that the man who focuses on his or her own needs and his or her own desires, they will live in uncertainty. They will lack security in this life. They will not truly have the happiness that they are searching for, because the things that they're pursuing can't give them those things. But the righteous man or woman who focuses on the Lord God and who desires to do God's will, they are those who will have all their desires fulfilled by God in his grace. What is the difference? The wicked will lose everything. The righteous will gain everything, because we have the Lord God who gives us everything. And so when the psalmist speaks about the delight in the law of God, well, you know, when we talk about the law, I think our first reaction is, because also the English language, the word that's used, law, we think about rules, we think about regulations that God gives us. People often have the idea that, and even many Christians may even have this idea, that to be a Christian means you live by certain rules and certain regulations. And so many have the idea that the Christians live by all sorts of rules, and so Christians, they think they're busy studying the law like a lawyer will study the law of the country and try to apply the law in every minute little detail in every minute situation in our lives. Well, beloved, verse 2 reveals something quite different when it talks about delighting in the law of God. First of all, the word law in the Hebrew is the word Torah, Torah. Torah is a word that means direction, instruction, and then law. And so you can say that the whole of God's Word, the whole Bible is God's Torah. It is His instructions for us. And the reason that God's law is such a delight is why? Because the law teaches us about the Lord God, teaches us about the ways of the Lord God. You see, beloved, you can never ever separate God's law from His covenant relationship with you. In His law, God comes to us with the gospel message, and He says, I am the Lord your God. Remember how He came to the people of Israel at Mount Sinai after He delivered them out of Egypt? He says, I am the Lord your God who has delivered you there from slavery and from bondage in Egypt. How did God approach His people in His law in the Old Testament? Today, the Lord God comes to us with His gospel message, and He says, I am the Lord your God. I am the one who sent to you my very own Son, Jesus Christ, to save you from your sins. So you notice, beloved, the very God who saves us is also the God who now instructs us how we are to live as His children. The reason that God's law, His word, is such a delight is that it teaches us about God's grace. We learn about God's mercy. And that's why we want to search the word of God. We want to discover from God's word how we may live as God's children, how we may be faithful to Him, how we may glorify Him in our life. That's why he speaks about meditating on the law day and night. This week in the Inquirer's course, we were talking about the law. And we also took a look at Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4 and following. This is where Moses gives instruction to the people of Israel, to the parents. And he exhorts the parents in Israel. He says, you need to impress on your children the law of God. You are to do that, he says, when you sit down, when you walk, and when you lie down, and when you get up. Basically, the way it says, he says, all day long, parents, you need to be teaching your children about the ways of the Lord. That doesn't mean that parents need to be reading the Bible all day long to their children. I don't think any children would ever be able to handle that, and you would not have your children be able to pay attention that long if you were to do that. Probably have a hard enough time at the supper table to keep their attention, and you have a short passage. What it means is this. It means that throughout the day, there are all these different moments when as parents, you're able to teach your children about the ways of the Lord. When something happens, and then you also remind the children, but what does the Lord want from you? How should you act here as a child of God? And there you bring the law of God into play as to how they are to react as God's children. So the result is that when our children grow up and they become young adults, they don't need to be thinking all the time about what does God want now here in this situation. No, they already know, generally speaking, in most situations, what's right and what is wrong. Why? Because the will of God has simply become a part of their life because they have been immersed there in the law of God their whole life as they were growing up. And therefore, you can say that a righteous person is somebody who's steeped there in the Word of God. Yesterday morning, men's breakfast, we talked about the value of memorizing Scripture. And the men also recognized that there is some value to there. Actually, there is a lot of value to that. Because it constantly, what it does, it helps us to connect our hearts and our minds to God. And it makes possible for us to also meditate on what God teaches us. As we remember those texts and those verses of Scripture, we are again reminded, oh, this is what God says. And this is how we are to react. And this is how we are to serve the Lord. So as believers, we do not want to let the thoughts and the ideas and the philosophy of this world to influence the way that we think and we live. Just think, beloved, all day we're being bombarded with the philosophies and the ideas of the world. You're bombarded by that with the people that you meet, perhaps at work. You're bombarded by it every time you put on your TV set or you listen to the radio. There you have the philosophy of the world being thrown at you. And if that is the only thing which you immerse yourself, you know what happens? After a while, you begin to take over the very ideas and you take over the very lifestyle that the world does, because we are no longer in tune to what the will of God is. And so, as God's children, we want to study, and we want to think about, and we want to meditate on what God has revealed in His law. And we ask ourselves, so how does Lord God, how does He want me to live? Because I know, I believe with my whole heart that walking in the way of the Lord will be a great blessing in my life. And that becomes clear in the contrast that you find here between the righteous and the wicked in verses 3 and 4. It says the righteous person will be blessed, but the wicked, but not the wicked, those who reject God. The difference here is that the righteous person is one who depends on the Lord. The wicked person is one who depends on him or herself for everything in their life. When you depend on God for everything, you can expect, beloved, you can expect His blessing. But you can be sure of this. If you depend upon yourself for everything, you're going to become hopelessly lost. The wicked, they're blind to that, and they refuse to see that dependent on themselves is going to be detrimental for their eternal well-being. Well, first of all, the psalmist talks about the righteous are, he says, like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. Well, think of the climate there in Palestine where the psalmist would have grown up. It's arid, it's a dry climate. The trees, they're needed to be planted near a source of water in order for them to be able to thrive. You know, if there's no water, the tree will wither. The leaves will fall off. And over time, if there's no water, then the tree will even die. But the tree that's planted along streams of water will grow tall and strong. And they will be green and vigorous, and they will bear lots of fruit. They will prosper. And so you notice here, then, the righteous are compared to such a tree planted by streams of water. The illustration teaches that the righteous are like trees planted by the streams of water. That means, and that water, you can say, is God's living word. So God's living word is to be the very source for our life. Because it is through that very gospel that the Lord God comes and He powerfully renews our heart and He causes His law to be written on our heart. This week, in the course, we talked about how the law of God exposes what lives in our heart. And when our heart is being exposed, so that, for example, when God says, you shall not steal, but we realize that if I envy somebody or have greed in my heart, then we realize, you know what, I constantly deal with envy, and I constantly deal with the greediness that lives in my heart. And as we begin to see what's so living in our heart, what we see isn't very pretty. But the sinful attitudes are being exposed. But God's law does much more than just expose our sins. God's law, beloved, also causes us to fall down on our knees as we recognize, I have grieved the Lord God. And in repentance, I turn to the Lord God and say, Lord, forgive me. Lord, please also give me the power of your Spirit so that I might live with this new attitude in my heart. See, the righteous, beloved, are those who cry out to the Lord, Lord, help me to live anew. Help me not only to see my sins, but also help me to live as your faithful child. Help me to put away my selfish attitude so that I may serve you and I may serve my neighbor with my whole heart. That's the kind of life, beloved, that will prosper. Well, you may be poor. Perhaps you may never ever get rich in an earthly way with money. But you will be rich spiritually as you bear fruit in the service of the Lord. You can be self-absorbed. Oh, your whole life can be around yourself like the wicked whose lives are self-absorbed. Or you can, on the other hand, you can be a blessing in the lives of others as you put the needs of others before your own and willing to sacrifice for them. The one way, when you look only out for your own needs, perhaps that may make you rich materially. Even then, you probably need to be lucky. But on the other hand, when we live in wisdom, then we will be rich spiritually. And when we're rich spiritually, that also brings joy into your life as you glorify the Lord. But not so the wicked, verse 4 says. The wicked are not blessed that way. They're like chaff that the wind blows away. Well, you know, the chaff is the useless part of the kernel of grain that's around the grain and protects it when the grain is growing, but at the end it's worthless. And so when the wheat is harvested, the wheat is separated from the chaff that you don't want. And in those days, the way that they would separate the chaff from the wheat is that they would throw the wheat up into the air while there was a strong breeze. And as the breeze came along, it would blow away the chaff because it was so light, whereas the kernel of grain would fall back down to the ground. Well, the wicked and evildoers, you can say, they really have no substance. They're like chaff. Oh, they think that they're intelligent. They think that they're wise. That's why they're mockers. They mock the believers. They mock the righteous, saying, how can you be so foolish and so stupid that you go and you sacrifice all these things and you listen to God when you could do your own thing and you could follow the desires of and the passions of your own heart? But the psalmist says, but really, you know what? They have no understanding. You may remember last week we dealt with Psalm 92, verse 6. It says that the senseless man does not know. The senseless man does not know what? He does not know, the psalmist says, how great God's works are. And the senseless man does not know how profound God's thoughts and God's plans are. Remember senseless? Literally means the mind or the brain of an animal. The wicked, the psalmist in Psalm 92 says, have a mind like that of animals that cannot understand, that is unable to see the great works of God, cannot see how profound the plans and the ways of God really are. Oh, the wicked, they boast about their greatness. They boast about rejecting the ways of the Lord. They boast about following the selfish desires of their own heart. They boast about the great achievements they're going to have in this life. The psalmist says, but they're like chaff. They're like lightweights. They are nothing. And that the wind will just blow away. Notice how dismissive the psalmist is of the wicked. For although they may boast, he says, in the end, they will have nothing to show for their life. And then he says, the righteous, they will bear much fruit, and they will be greatly blessed by the Lord. Beloved, there are two ways to live. The question this morning is, which way will you choose? Will you choose to live for the Lord, or are you going to choose to live for yourself? And you'll walk in the counsel and the advice of the wicked. You see, the choice that you make today, beloved, will have eternal consequences. Take a look at verse 5, verse 6, the end of the psalm. Where the psalmist concludes this, he says, therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. See, God's people in the Old Testament, they understood. The psalmist understood that a day of judgment is coming. And he understood that the choice that you make today, whether you walk and come to faithfulness with the Lord or not, whether you take delight in the law of the Lord, that will determine what's going to happen on that day of judgment. And the psalmist says, the wicked will not stand in the judgment. They'll not stand in the judgment means that they will perish and they will be destroyed. They can't stand up against God's wrath and against God's anger. Neither, he says, will they stand in the assembly of the righteous. Right? The assembly here are the people who are gathered, who are righteous before God. And on that day of judgment, he says, the wicked, they will be separated from that assembly of the righteous who have served the Lord God. And so the wicked will be separated from the righteous on that day. It will be like the wheat harvest, where the grain is thrown up into the air and the chaff is blown away. And so on the day of judgment, the wicked will be separated from the believers. They will be cast into everlasting condemnation and hell. And so the psalmist ends with these sobering words. The wicked will perish. They may boast today. They may be confident in their wickedness and their sin. But the reality, the psalmist says, is that they're living under the curse of God today. God's judgment is coming. But because they have the mind of a beast, like that of an animal, they cannot comprehend it. They cannot even begin to see that the day of judgment is fast approaching. On the other hand, the psalmist says, the Lord watches over the way of the righteous. Well, one way to understand the way it's translated here in our translation is to think that the Lord God is watching over our life and he's seeing and looking at the way in which we're living. In this sense, you could say God is watching to see whether we're living as his people and whether we're really serving him as he desires that of us every day again. That's kind of a colder way of looking at God's relationship with us. You see, that word watching literally means to know, as a husband knows his wife, as a wife knows her husband. And therefore, the idea is not that the Lord God is now watching over our life from far away there in heaven. And he's just kind of that cold, calculating judge who's kind of looking to see how we are living and whether we're keeping his laws or not. And that will determine whether we're going to be saved or not. No, the psalmist is speaking here about something else. He's talking about an intimate relationship that already exists today between God and us. He says, the Lord knows the way of the righteous. That means, beloved, that he intimately knows what lives in your heart today. He knows you as a husband and wife know each other very intimately. He knows your love for him in your heart. He knows the joy and the gratitude that lives in your heart for the salvation that he has given to you through his Son, Jesus Christ. He knows how much you delight in his law. And he knows how you are striving each day to live faithfully as his child. And oh, the Lord also knows. He knows your weakness. He knows how you're struggling with sin, also in your heart. But he also sees the sorrow in your heart. And he sees the sincere repentance in your heart when you turn to the Lord your God. You seek his grace. And the Lord God, he knows us in such an intimate way that he doesn't hold those sins against us and those weaknesses against us. But for the sake of his Son, he will also forgive us and he will shower us. Yes, even shower us with his blessing. Indeed, beloved, blessed are the righteous, those who love the Lord, those who take great delight in the law of God. Remember, it is the way of life that gives great joy. In him, beloved, you are truly blessed. In him, you may experience true happiness. Amen.